It is Tecmo Tuesday, and this is the last video of Season 2, where I'll be just running a recap or highlight reel of the last half of the season. I already did the first half of the season at the midpoint of Season 2 earlier on, so I'll be running the recap of the games from Week 10 and beyond. And then next week, I'll start the next season, which will be the 1993 Colts. I mentioned earlier that this would be the end of my, I guess you could say, Colts arc. Finish off the trilogy with 93, and then move on to something else next time. But for now, let's see what happened in 92. So coming into the second half of the season in Week 10 with a 7-1 record, the Colts took on the Dolphins. First possession for Miami. Marino heaves it up for Mark Duper in double coverage, and he makes the catch anyway, getting the Dolphins in the red zone. That would set up another dangerous pass for Marino in tight coverage that also pays off, this time to Mark Clayton, the other Mark's brother, for first down inside the 5. That sets up Tony Page on the next play for a 2-yard run, and Miami strikes first, 7-0. Both teams trade punts, and on the next Colt possession, Jeff George takes off, but is stripped naked of the ball, and it's recovered by Marco Coleman, and the Dolphins take possession. The drive stalls out, though, and Pete Stojanovic knocks in a 48-yard field goal to extend the Dolphins' lead to 10-0. Colts punt it away again, and on third down, Marino finds Clayton again, and Miami goes up 17-0 at halftime. Colts get the ball to start the third, and George finally gets something going with Reggie Langhorne with a pass down to midfield. Later in the drive, it's third down and another blitz, and George once again hits Langhorne in double coverage for the touchdown to get Indy on the board 17-7. Dolphins answer right back though. Tony Page takes the handoff, breaks a tackle, and rumbles all the way for a 70-yard touchdown run to put the Dolphins up 23-7. The extra point was blocked. First play of the next possession for the Colts, George heaves it up for Reggie Langhorne for a touchdown, and it keeps the Colts' head above water, 23-14 at the end of the third quarter. But nobody was stopping these Dolphins receivers. Clayton makes another catch in tight coverage and breaks the tackle, bringing the ball all the way to Indy's 37. Then on third down, Marino connects to Clayton again on a deep pass to the 8-yard line, which sets up Tony Page again for a touchdown run, 30-14. Colts would come roaring back with a touchdown pass to Jesse Hester to make the score 30-21, but they failed to recover the onside kick. Miami set up for a field goal try, which was blocked, but Keith Jackson recovers for Miami and actually picks up the first down and keeps the drive alive. That would set up Tony Page again busting through the defenders for the touchdown run in the final seconds to close out the scoring 37-21. This was just Miami's day. The Colts couldn't stop Tony Page or defend any of Marino's needle threading to receivers in tight windows. It didn't help that the Colts got off to such a slow start offensively and couldn't dig themselves out of the 17-0 hole, and actually finished the game with 0 yards rushing. Ouch. Next up, the New England Patriots, who got the ball first, and as most teams do against the Colts, got off to a big start. As Kevin Turner takes the pitch, breaks a tackle, and goes the distance 81 yards for the touchdown to put the pads up 7-0. Both teams exchange punts, and the Colts get a big play from Rodney Culver out of the backfield to take the ball into New England territory. Drive stalls out, though, and Indy has to settle for a field goal to make the score 7-3 pads. Next possession, Hugh Millen tosses it deep to Irving Fryer, who makes a leaping catch and takes it the rest of the way to give the Pats a 13-3 lead. They miss the kick wide, and that would be the score at halftime. Late third quarter, Millen finds starving Marvin Cook, who splits two diving defenders and takes the ball down to the 23. That would set up a field goal, and the Patriots go up 16-3. Colts matriculate the ball down the field, and with less than 4 minutes left, on fourth down, George finds Kerry Cash to make the score 16-10. Next possession, Kevin Turner does it again, makes a few men miss, and it's 23-10 with 2.5 minutes left. First play of the next drive, George finds Reggie Langhorne deep down the sideline to make it 23-17. Colts can't recover the onside kick, and with only 1:26 left in the game, they need a miracle. They get a couple quick sacks and force a punt, but with only 15 seconds left, all they can do is throw it up for grabs. and a busted coverage leaves Kerry Cash wide open down the sideline for the Hail Mary touchdown to win the game. And that missed extra point turned out to be very important in the outcome, and the Colts improved to 8-2 with a 24-23 victory. Next up, the Pittsburgh Steelers. Pittsburgh gets the ball first, and Merrill Hodge takes the pitch, and the defense takes all the wrong angles, leading to another opening drive touchdown surrendered for the Colts, 7-0 Pittsburgh. Colts drive down the field, but stall out and have to settle for a 52-yard field goal, which goes off the upright, and Pittsburgh maintains its 7-point lead. That lead would be extended when Neil O'Donnell finds Jeff Graham wide open along the sideline for a 52-yard touchdown pass to make the score 14-0 Pittsburgh. The Colts are forced to punt, and the Steelers drive down the field. O'Donnell hits Adrian Cooper, who makes a few guys miss, and takes it in for the touchdown, 21-0 now. The Colts have to punt it away, but right before halftime, O'Donnell throws an ill-advised pass that gets picked off by Mike Pryor. 9 seconds left in the half, only a Hail Mary will suffice, and calling the same play that led to the Hail Mary miracle win from last week, George finds Kerry Cash deep to get the touchdown and make it 21-7 at the half, with the Colts getting the ball to start the third. What a momentum shift. Next possession, George throws it out in the flat, but a diving catch causes the interception, but he fumbles it right back to the Colts, so first down. Colts matriculate the ball down the field. Are we going to see another come-from-behind win with a crazy finish? Well, we're getting closer to that after this short pass to Langhorne in the end zone makes it 21-14. Pittsburgh's forced to punt, and with 2.5 minutes left in regulation, George finds Cash again deep for another touchdown, and the game is tied at 21. O'Donnell hits Cooper, who leaps up in the air to make the catch, makes a few men miss, and gets a huge gain, although he does get hurt on the play. That sets up Barry Bananas Foster, who runs right by the over-pursuing defenders, who come charging through with the blitz to go up 28-21, and that would be the final score in the game. After going down 21-0 to start the game, the Colts scored 21 unanswered points to shut the Steelers out for the remainder of the game until the very end. The slow starts have got to change, though, as the Colts have now lost 2 of the last 3 games, which would be 3 straight losses if it weren't for a miracle Hail Mary the prior week. Well, moving on to a massively important game against the 9-2 Bills, who beat Indy in overtime earlier in the season. A win here would put the Colts in a tie for first. A loss would all but put the division title out of reach. The Colts always give up a touchdown on the first drive, so the high-powered Bills offense will score right away for sure, right? Wrong. Mike Pryor makes the interception and is followed up with a deep shot to Reggie Langhorne, who jukes out a few defenders and takes it all the way for the touchdown, so it's 7-0 Colts. Next Bills drive, Kelly throws deep to Andre Reed in double coverage, who makes the catch somehow. A lot of fireworks early here. But the Colts hold off the drive, and Steve Christie punches a field goal through off the upright and in to make the score 7-3. Next drive, George connects with Langhorne again on a deep pass into Buffalo territory. That would set up George across the field to Maurice Carthon, who takes it to the end zone 14-3 Colts. Next drive for the Bills, Kelly throws it to James Lofton, who catches in tight coverage, becoming a recurring theme here. And it leads to a run by Thurman Thomas into the end zone to make the score 14-10. As the first half winds down, George finds Cash over the middle, who gets a bunch of extra yards down to the Bills' 33. George looking for Cash in the end zone, but he ends up throwing an interception that closes out the half at 14-10 Colts. Indy does get the ball to start the third, and they continue their aggressive game plan, going deep to Langhorne again, who's wide open, taking the ball to the 13. That would set up a third down strike to Langhorne for the touchdown, putting the Colts up 21-10. But these are the early 90s Bills, and they will not die. And Kelly finds Reed deep again, and that sets up Thurman with a run into the end zone to make the score 21-16 after the Colts block the extra point. George finds Cash over the middle, who gets a lot of yards after the catch, taking the ball into Bills territory. Same drive, fourth quarter. Maurice Carthon takes the ball up the middle on 3rd and 1 and converts for the first down. Carthon would get some more tough running throughout the drive, culminating in a 3-yard run into the end zone to go up 28-16 and put the game out of reach. But like I said, this is the early 90s Bills, and no one circles the wagons like the Buffalo Bills. They give it to Thurman, and he basically runs the length of the field, making it 28-23. The onside kick, however, was kept by the Colts, and they end up getting an insurance touchdown at the very end after Culver almost takes it the distance on a long run. Carthon puts the exclamation point on, and the Colts win 35-23 to exact revenge and even things up in the standings. Thurman Thomas was a madman running the ball for the Bills, and their receivers were catching everything in blanketed coverage. But this time, the Colts' offense didn't start slow and was on top of their game from beginning to end for a change. Week 14 is a rematch with the Patriots. Indy gets an interception early on when Hugh Millen's pass gets snagged by John Baylor. Colts can't take advantage though and are forced to punt. On the next drive, Millen overthrows Greg McMurtry and Baylor comes up with another INT. First play of the second quarter, Jeff George tosses it up for Langhorne, who brings it inside the five. That would set up Rodney Culver for the short touchdown run, and the Colts strike first, 7-0. First play of the next possession for New England, Kevin Turner does the same thing he did to the Indy defense last game. Absolutely burn him with a long touchdown, outrunning the entire defense to tie the game at 7. But the Colts answer right back when Clarence Verdon gets a huge kickoff return, setting up Indy in great field position, which sets up Maurice Carthon punching it in to give the Colts the lead right back 14-7. The Patriots miss a long field goal, which leaves 17 seconds on the clock, which is just enough time for George to launch it into the end zone from a mile away, and Langhorne makes the catch in a crowd. The Patriots just cannot stop the Hail Mary, and it's 21-7 at halftime. The Colts get the ball to start the third and matriculate the ball down the field. They have to settle for a field goal, but at 24-7, they make it a three-score game and burn half the quarter with the drive. Patriots do get a deep pass on the next drive to starving Marvin Cook, which sets up a field goal to bring it back to a two-score game, 24-10. Clarence Verdon, who had the big return earlier, ends up getting injured on the ensuing kickoff. Colts' next drive is a lot like the last one, a long sustaining drive that leads to a field goal with just over 2 minutes left. Pats get a garbage time touchdown run from John Vaughn to make the final score more respectable at 27-17, but that was it. Turnovers really killed the Patriots in this one, with two early interceptions that really set the tone, and the Hail Mary at the end of the half tacked on another score that dug a hole the Pats couldn't get out of. And with the Bills losing, the Colts are now in sole possession of first place in the AFC East. Next up, the New York Jets. Browning Nagel gets the Jets off to a hot start out of the gate with a deep pass to Chris Burkett, and then on 3rd and 6, Nagel finds Rob Moore to put the Jets up 7-0. George leads a drive to answer back and tie the game at 7 after a toss to Jesse Hester along the sideline. Next Jets possession, Brad Baxter takes the pitch and carves his way through the defense to the Colts 21-yard line. That sets up Nagel on a play-action fake and passes it to Blair Thomas for a touchdown to make it 14-7 Jets. Then Jeff George takes a sack and gets knocked out of the game, so Jack Trudeau comes in. First pass by Trudeau gets picked off by James Hasty, who jumps up to get it. That would set up Baxter, again on the pitch, and he takes it in to make it 21-7 Jets. Just when you thought the half was over, Brian Washington steps in front of Trudeau's pass and gets another interception with 2 seconds left in the half. But the Colts do block their field goal attempt to keep it a two-score lead at the break. Colts get the ball to start the third, and Trudeau throws deep to Hester, and now it's 21-14. But right after that, Blair Thomas takes the pitch, breaks a tackle, and rams it right down Indy's throats with an 80-yard scamper to the end zone, and it's 28-14 Jets. At the end of the third, Trudeau launches another desperate heave, this time to Langhorne to get the Colts inside the five, and then Trudeau takes it in himself to make the score 28-21. But Brad Baxter continues the assault on the Colts D on the next drive with an 80-yard run straight through, no problem, 35-21. A little over a minute to go on 4th and 21, Trudeau tosses another deep pass to Langhorne, who's wide open, and it brings the score to 35-28. But the Colts can't recover the onside kick, and Nagel throws an insurance touchdown to Baxter to make the final 42-28. The Jets just made mincemeat of the Colts' defense. And with the Bills' victory, the Colts are now tied once again for first place. Two games left to go in the regular season, though, and the penultimate game is against the 4-10 Cardinals. Clarence Verdon does come back from injury, but Jeff George does not, so Indy's going to have to rely on Trudeau again. Cards get the ball first, and Chris Chandler finds Ricky Prohl just out of reach of the defender for a first down. And then again, Prohl just beats his defender and brings it in for the touchdown, 7-0 Phoenix. Colts answer back when Trudeau finds Anthony Johnson, who leaps up to make the catch, which sets up Johnson from the 1 to tie the game at 7. Colts force a punt and get the ball back, but Rodney Culver fumbles the ball. It appears to fall out of bounds, but the Cardinals are still awarded the recovery, which sets up Chandler calling his own number and taking the lead back 14-7. Controversial. Trudeau finds Kerry Cash over the middle, and with the Colts' lives in his hands, he's got butterfingers, handing the ball right back to Phoenix, but they don't have enough time to get any points before halftime, and it's still 14-7. Early third quarter, Trudeau finds Langhorne deep, and just like that, it's tied again, 14-all. Cardinals start getting a nice drive together, but Johnny Bailey ends up fumbling, and the Colts recover. That sets up the Colts with a field goal. They're able to squeak off the upright and in to take the lead 17-14. With less than 3.5 minutes left, Johnny Bailey totally redeems himself with a run straight through the heart of the Colts' D, which can't stop a parked car lately, and it's 20-17 after the Colts block the PAT. On the ensuing kickoff, Verdon is fresh out of the hospital, but he can't hang on to the ball either and fumbles it back to Phoenix in a crucial moment. That would set up Prohl with a short touchdown run to put it out of reach, 27-17. Trudeau would get a desperate Hail Mary touchdown pass to Reggie Langhorne all the way across the field to make it 27-24, but that was in the closing seconds of the game, and there wasn't even enough time to attempt an onside kick. The Colts were bitten by the turnover bug badly in this game. Three fumbles, including a costly one in the fourth quarter, that denied their chance to get a game-winning drive started. And with a win by the Bills, the AFC East is beyond reach. The good news is that the Colts' record is good enough to clinch a playoff berth, but because the division title isn't going to happen, the decision was made to rest the offensive starters in the second half of their season finale with Cincinnati. Jeff George does come back from injury, so he'll get to play in the first half and try to shake some rust off. Bengals get the ball first, and Boomer Esiason chucks it up for Tim McGee, who reaches up to haul it in, bringing it down to the 22. That would set up Boomer to call Pickens, and like usual, the Colts' opponents strike first, 7-0. Clarence Verdon gets a huge return on the ensuing kickoff, bringing it into the red zone, but the drive stalls out, and Biasucci misses the field goal, still 7-0. Bengals take advantage when Derek Fenner knifes his way through the defense, and it's 14-0 early second quarter. Colts get some offense going this time, and George finds Kerry Cash for the touchdown, 14-7. Next Bengal drive, Rodney Holman makes a leaping catch between defenders, setting Cincinnati up at midfield, but then the Colts defense finally makes a play when Mike Pryor gets the interception. That would set up after a couple drop passes by Langhorne and Johnson, Jesse Hester coming through on third down, and then Kerry Cash makes the leaping catch to bring in the touchdown to tie the game at 14 at the end of the half. So now the backups are brought in to prevent any injuries. There have already been enough of them throughout the season. Colts' first drive of the second half stalls out, and they have to punt. Derek Fenner takes the delayed handoff and just obliterates the porous Colts' run defense for another huge touchdown run to make it 21-14 Cincinnati. Trudeau does lead the Colts back into scoring range, and he connects with Bill Brooks down the sideline for the game-tying touchdown early fourth quarter. The Bengals matriculate the ball down the field, but the drive stalls out in goal line territory, and they're forced to kick a field goal to go up 24-21. Trudeau tries to lead a last-minute drive, but ends up tossing a pick to Eric Thomas, and that's all she wrote, 24-21 Bengals. It would have been nice to come into the playoffs with some momentum, but everyone's healthy going into the wild card round against, who else, the Bengals again. Bengals get the ball first, but are forced to punt. Second play of the drive, George tosses it to Foghorn Langhorne, and he makes some moves, forces a few guys to miss, and takes it all the way down to the 4. That set up Rodney Culver taking it into the end zone, 7-0 Colts. Bengals go nowhere and punt it away again. George tosses it to Kerry Cash to get the ball inside the 30, and then finds him again over the middle for the touchdown, and it's 14-0 with less than a minute left in the first half. With 21 seconds left in the half, Harold Green takes the handoff and runs it all the way across the field for the touchdown. So despite getting severely outplayed in the first half, the Bengals cut the lead down to 7. Colts get the ball to start the third, and look at Rodney Culver here, shake off 1, 2, 3 tacklers. He really had his Wheaties today. The drive stalls out, and Dean Biasucci puts a field goal through to extend the lead to 17-7. Bengals move the ball into Indy territory, but a huge sack puts them out of any hopes for a field goal, and they have to punt it again. Bengals force Indy to punt themselves, but with only 4 minutes left, they've got to move. On 4th and 7, Derek Fenner takes the handoff, and John Baylor bypasses 2 blockers on his way to cutting him off at the pass and turning Cincy over on downs. George finds cash again for an insurance touchdown, and then Anthony Johnson takes in a garbage time score to make it 31-7 final. So the Colts advance to the divisional round to take on the Houston Oilers. Houston gets the ball first, and they run the draw to Lorenzo White, who makes a few moves, and he's off to the races for the touchdown, giving the Oilers a 7-0 lead, and the Colts revisit the theme of giving up a score on the first drive. Both teams trade punts, and on the last play of the first quarter, Jeff George finds Langhorne deep down the field all by his lonesome. He has to jump to make the catch, but he takes it the rest of the way to tie the game at 7. Next drive, Warren Moon keeps the ball, and he takes it all the way inside the 10. But on the next play, they try the same draw play, but Lorenzo White gets stuffed and was injured on the play. The Oilers do punch it in when Moon finds Ernest Givens from Louisville to take a 14-7 lead. With 2 minutes left in the half, a short kickoff and good return by Bill Brooks gives the Colts the ball at midfield. On third down, George, with plenty of time, finds Cash deep. He breaks a tackle and takes it into the end zone to tie it up once again. And that would be the score at the half. Third quarter, George finds Cash, who brings it inside the 10. Then Culver takes the ball to the 1, but the Houston defense stuffs Carthon just short of the end zone, and then they take Culver down behind the line of scrimmage. So a big goal line stand by the Oilers holds the Colts to a field goal, and it's 17-14. Next drive, Moon finds Hayward Jeffries, who turns on the Jets and brings it all the way to the end zone to take the lead back 21-17. On the ensuing kickoff, Brooks takes the ball into Houston territory, but it's a fumble, and somehow the Colts recover. It turns out to be a huge play, too, because 3 plays later, George finds Jesse Hester all alone in the end zone to give the Colts the lead right back 24-21 at the end of the third. The Oilers are forced to punt, and with under 4 minutes left, they need to make a stop. Instead, they forget once again to cover the wide receivers, and Langhorne is wide open once again for a huge gain, which would set up Rodney Culver running into the end zone to take the 31-21 lead, and that would be the final. Langhorne had 2 big catches for 146 yards, and they were able to get just enough out of their running game to keep the offense balanced. And the Colts D showed up when it mattered most to get the victory. Move on to the AFC Championship, take on their third straight AFC Central opponent, Pittsburgh Steelers. Steelers get the ball first, and they matriculate the ball down the field with some runs, intermediate passes, and capping it all off with a 23-yard run by Merrill Hodge, straight through the defense to get the first score of the game, 7-0, and run most of the first quarter out in the process. Jeff George answers right back with a pass to Clarence Verdon along the sidelines to tie the game at 7 as the first quarter ends. Pittsburgh doesn't go anywhere and is forced to punt it away. On 3rd and long, George finds Verdon, who just gets enough for the first down, and then Maurice Carthon shifts gears and takes off all the way to the 7. 2 plays later, Culver fumbles, but the Colts manage to keep it, setting up a field goal to make it 10-7 Colts at halftime. Colts get the ball to start the third and are driving to maybe take a 10-point lead, but Jeff George is strip sacked and Kenny Davidson picks it up, and it's 14-10 Pittsburgh all of a sudden. But George goes back to the deep ball and airmails it to Kerry Cash, who takes it to the end zone, 17-14 Colts. Toward the end of the third, Pittsburgh drives down into Indy territory, but Cooper fumbles it right back to the Colts. Fourth quarter now, and 3rd and 1, the Steelers blow up the line and take Culver down for a loss of 2. Colts decide to go for it on 4th and 3, and George connects to Cash for the first down. Indy matriculates the ball down the field, and then on a key 3rd and goal from the 4, George finds Cash again, and it's 24-14 now. A failed conversion and a field goal would have given the Steelers a chance to drive for the win. Instead, this would be the final score of the game, and the Colts would advance to the Super Bowl to take on the juggernaut San Francisco 49ers. Niners get the ball first, and on 3rd down, Tom Rathman almost gets taken down behind the marker, but manages to break through and scamper for the 1st down and takes it into Indy territory. Then Ricky Waters makes a catch down to the 1, and then Steve Young finds Brent Jones in the end zone in a crowd, and it's 7-0 San Francisco. Colts are forced to punt, although they flirted with the idea of going for it on 4th and 1, but decided to kick it away. Steve Young scrambles and takes the ball all the way down to the 10. Colts manage to hold them to a field goal here, though, so it's 10-0 San Fran. Colts matriculate the ball down the field, and on 3rd down, George finds Cash open in the end zone, but it's just out of reach, and the Colts have to settle for a field goal, 10-3, 49ers at the half. Colts get the ball to start the 3rd, and Rodney Culver takes the handoff and makes 1 man miss, 2 men miss, he basically makes the whole team miss, until finally getting brought down on the 3. That sets up Maurice Carthon up the middle to tie the game at 10. Colts manage to hold the high-powered 49ers offense to a punt, and the Colts start getting a good drive going. But on the last play of the 3rd quarter, as Carthon gets to the 20, he fumbles and the Niners recover. Young finds Brent Jones over the middle, and he takes it to the 6. That would set up Ricky running Waters up the middle to make it 17-10 with 3:16 left in regulation. George, under pressure, throws to Clarence Verdon, who leaps up to make the catch for the 1st down. Then George goes deep to Carthon, who brings it to the 7. Niners hold them to 4th down with 29 seconds left, and with everything on the line, George finds Kerry Cash in the end zone just as a defender closes in on him, and we move to overtime. 49ers win the coin toss, and on the 2nd play of overtime, Rathman takes the handoff up the middle and plows through the defense and takes it all the way to pay dirt and a championship. 23-17 is the final in a walk-off touchdown. A heartbreaking way for the game and season to end, but it was a hell of a game and a hell of a season. We'll see how it goes in '93.